The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room.
You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work,
when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage. Born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Welcome to the real world.
I know you're out there. I can feel you now. I know that you're afraid. You're afraid of us. You're afraid of change. I don't know the future. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. I'm going to hang up this phone, and then I'm going to show these people what you don't want them to see. I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible. Where we go from there is a choice I leave to you.
And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of Truth Frequency. This is your host, Chris Geo, and I'm joined as always by my lovely co-host, Cherie. It is March 18th, 2010, and joining us in a few minutes will be Dr. Brooks Agnew. He is a teacher, scientist, engineer, talk show host, and Earth explorer. We're going to be discussing the Hollow Earth, 2012, and higher consciousness. But since 2012 seems to be such a big subject, we're going to have our good friend Nancy Wallace come on the line for a little bit and tell us what her predictions are for 2012, because she's got something completely different to say, and I thought all of the listeners out there would be interested to get all perspectives. So, Socio, why don't you tell us a little bit about some of the theories about 2012, and then we'll get right into Nancy here in a few minutes.
There's a lot of different theories about 2012. People usually point to the Mayan long count calendar, first of all, and they say that in 2012, it'll be the end of a 5,125-year-long cycle. A New Age interpretation of this transition says that during this time, the Earth and its inhabitants may undergo a positive physical or spiritual transformation. And that's kind of what me and Chris believe, too. We think it's going to be more of like a slow transition into a more awakened
like a global humanity. Shift in consciousness, absolutely.
Right.
And that's why we're on here doing what we do every Thursday night, 7 p.m. Central Time at Truth Frequency Radio, to kind of try to help people shift, you know, beyond that five-sense reality. And as a matter of fact, I have a great announcement. We're going to be doing a show every Saturday, 7 p.m. Central Time on AmericanFreedomRadio.com. That's Jack Blood's network. So we're real honored with that. That's going to go out on AM and FM. Really a great step in the right direction. But anyways, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
That's okay. Other prophecies and apocalyptic writings and hypotheses for this year include Terence McKenna's mathematical novelty theory, which predicts a point of singularity in which humankind will go through a great shift in consciousness, exactly like we were saying. Also, the prophecy of the popes attributed to St. Malachy speculated that Pope Benedict XVI would reign during the beginning of the tribulation of which Jesus spoke, and sometime later a future pope described in prophecy as Peter the Roman, the last of in this prophetic list, would appear, bringing as a result the destruction of the city of Rome and the last judgment. Well, weren't you saying something about that a few months ago, about how they only have enough room for one more pope?
They have picture frames in the Vatican, and there's only one more picture frame left after this pope, and that will be the last pope. And it's like they somehow know they know the prophecies, but it's like they're somehow counting on the prophecies coming true.
Right. And many New Age spiritualists and philosophers believe that humankind will enter an age of enlightenment. But see, then you have the other side of the spectrum. People that really think that something really bad's going to happen in 2012, like a geomagnetic reversal, also called a pole shift, or that a planet X or Nibiru will collide with our planet or pass by it that year. That's been going around since 1995.
Well, we're definitely seeing Earth changes. I don't know if anybody's noticed, but the moon seems to be upside down. We noticed that, and so we Googled it, and it looks like a lot of people are coming to the same conclusion that the moon is actually upside down.
Yeah,
what's causing that? I don't know. But I do know we just had the earthquake, and that actually sped up the day a little bit. We're a millisecond faster now.
Right, exactly. And the other ones are a black hole alignment, which I don't believe. That just sounds kind of silly anyway. And then the Webb-Bob
project. Well, what's going to happen is that, you know, this could be easily refuted because it's from a perspective. It's only from Earth's perspective, but we're going to align with the center of the galaxy, and there's supposedly a black hole in the center of the galaxy, and that can cause all kinds of havoc. We're definitely seeing some Earth changes, like I said, and what we need to do is figure out why are we seeing these Earth changes. And I wonder to myself, is this global warming thing, was it supposed to be a cover for a coming pole shift or something like that, that they know that there's nothing that anybody can do about it? So this global warming could just be a cover? I don't know. I mean, that's why we're going to have somebody like Brooks Agnew come on, give us his perspective on
it. Well, and if you look at it from a five-sense reality type of thing, it does seem like DARPA and the other companies that work for the military and work for the government who are developing all this new technology, it's like they're preparing for something. And I don't know what that is, but they're even making robots that can not only see things but can understand what people are doing just by looking at a scene and seeing people walking around. They can tell what you're going to be doing. You know, it's really weird stuff. I've got an article here to read whenever we get back from this break.
Absolutely. I mean, we have two different perspectives coming on the show. We have Nancy Wallace, she's a psychic, and then we have Brooks Agnew, who's a scientist. So it's going to be real interesting to hear what they both have to say about 2012. This is Truth Frequency on truthfrequencyradio.com. We'll be back in just a few minutes.
Who controls the web? The spider controls the web. And the spider is at a level that you never see. It's not Tony Blair. He's a strand. The Bush family, they're a strand. Even the Rockefellers are a strand. The real power that's manipulating all this, you never see. It operates from the shadows. So it's operating to a centrally dictated policy. And this is why you're seeing the same things happen in all different countries at the same time. It's because the orders and the policy are coming from a central point. We can work on the level of banking scams, political scams, manipulated wars, manipulated 9/11s, and we should, because we need to know that. But if that's all we're doing in terms of communicating knowledge, then basically we're operating in a cycle of this is the problem, but how the hell do we get out of this? We will never know how to set ourselves free until we understand the nature of who we bloody well are. How do you set yourself free when you don't even know who you are? How do you set yourself free when you don't even know the nature of reality that you're living in and manifesting and making happen without your knowledge that you're making it happen? You can't. So alongside the information about, you know, the five sense level of this conspiracy, if you like, we have to, just as powerfully, I would say more powerfully, communicate the nature of reality and how we are creating our reality and how we are allowing it to be created for us by having ourselves programmed with certain beliefs, certain perceptions, and all the rest of it all the time. The two must go together. Otherwise, you know, we're never going to get out of this.
All freedom is our natural and eternal right, not the gift of some dark suit or uniform to decide if it's going to give it to us or not.
And welcome back to Truth Frequency. This is your host, Chris Geo, and I'm joined, as always, by my lovely co-host, Cherie. And we are broadcasting on TruthFrequencyRadio.com. And don't forget, every Saturday, we will be on American Freedom Radio at 7 o'clock Central Time. So be sure to check out that show. It's going to be a great show going out on AM and FM affiliates. But right now on the line, we have Nancy Wallace. She's a good friend of ours. If you don't know who Nancy is, go back through our archives, check out the first show, because she talked a lot about who she is and how she came to be at the point where she is now. But I want to get her take on 2012 and see what she has to say. So let's see. Nancy, do we have you on the line?
Yes, you do. Hi.
Hi. It's so nice to hear from you.
It's great. It's great being on again.
Great. Well, you know, we were discussing just a few days ago off air. Well, I guess first and foremost, for the listeners who don't know who you are, maybe you can tell us a little bit about your background, just in a nutshell, but I want to jump right to 2012.
Okay. In a nutshell, I've been an intuitive life coach for 35 years, moved to New Mexico to open a new school under my 501c3 for children who have been labeled with ADD, ADHD, problem children, children don't fit the bell curve, and children that are just downright bored. So that's what I've been doing.
Excellent. And your website is nancypsychicresources.com and the School of Now website.
And it's the www.childsmiraclemind.org.
Excellent. I have to say, ladies and gentlemen, that I get readings and advice from Nancy, and everything that she said has been spot on. I mean, it's really amazing. So, you know, we were discussing 2012 and what your angels were saying the other day. Can you go into that a little bit?
I'd love to. Yeah, from the time I was 6 years old when I had a freak accident, I've had these angels talking to me, at least to me they're angels. I don't ask their names because I really don't care what their names are, but they give me lots and lots of insight. In fact, they're the ones who actually help me get through everything I've gone through. But they did give me different kinds of predictions that they figured was going to be going on, and a lot of different visuals that go with it. And it's not that the world is going to end. I know right now the media and all those people out there are going, oh, it's going to be horrible, it's going to be horrible, it's going to be horrible. Well, in reality, it's not really going to be horrible. However, there are going to be a lot of changes. Without the changes, not only will the world, the planet, not make it, the people on the planet won't make it. So the Earth itself is going to have to make some shifts to kind of clean itself of excess debris. And that's kind of like the things that we have done. We're basically killing this planet. And since this planet is a living, breathing thing, it's going to do its survival. And the survival is getting rid of things it doesn't need. So 2012, to me, is just a lot of changes coming in. But it also denotes, from what I have seen from my angels, that a lot of systems are going to fail. And you're kind of already seeing it, because everybody talks about 2012, but my angels told me 2010. 2010 to 2015, 2017, lots of changes. But it's going to take us until 2050 to actually have the planet in a very nice, neutral, loving state. So 40 years worth of changes that this planet will be going through, and everybody who is on it. Will some people die? Yes, they will. Will some people choose not to be here? Yes, they will. The energy that's coming in right now during 2010 is a very hard energy. So a lot of people right now get very depressed. They want to cry. They don't know why. They're all worried. They're all stressed. You know, and it's a lot of the energy that's coming in that's creating all of that. So for 2012, it's already started. So you folks out there know it's already started. A lot of changes have occurred. Just look at the earthquakes that's already gone on. A lot of tornadoes going to be coming in. You know, more of kind of disastrous weather. But again, that's what's going to have to take place in order for the world to get itself back to a neutral position. Does that help that?
So we've basically done it to ourselves.
Yeah, we basically have. I mean, one thing that this planet has really forgotten how to do is to love. And until we learn how to do that again, we're all kind of in sad shape, because this planet right now is very power hungry, very greedy, and everybody only wants to cover their own butt rather than try to work together to make it a much better place. And so part of our learnings from 2010 through 2012 and into 2015, 2017 is to find that love within ourselves again, you know, like who we are, love who we are, so that we can, you know, emit that from us so that other people around us will do the same. That's this big change that's coming.
Well, how do we do that though when everything is constantly bombarded. Everybody's constantly bombarded by pharmaceuticals, propaganda on television. If you try to get somebody to listen to a show like this, they, you know, will laugh at you, and they'd rather go drink beer and watch American Idol. How do we reach those people?
Well, the best way is to let some of those people kind of have their falls, because they are going to. See, people are notorious for trying to find ways not to wake up. And part of this change that's coming now all the way through to like 2015, 2017, is what they're considering to be ascension. In other words, making it better for yourself, you know, being more spiritual. The best thing is to turn off the televisions, turn off the radios, don't read the newspapers, because they really make people sit there and fret and worry, and then they do all these sales ads to make you think, well, I'll go have a beer and everything will be hunky-dory. You know, so the best way is to really not listen to the media. And when it comes to the pharmaceutical companies, they're going to always, always, always try to get people on drugs, because that's the way that they control you. That's the way they make a lot of money, and that's the way the human people get sick. But I understand that a lot of people go, oh, don't take a drug. Are you kidding? I'd never make it. Well, yeah, you would, because there's a lot of other things out there that could help you. You know, the natural herbs, all of those things. But you know what? Congress and those guys are trying to eliminate any kind of supplements. In other words, vitamins of any kind, herbs that actually help people, they're trying to eliminate it. And there's a bill going on right now. I don't know the name of it, but I've been sent tons of emails about it. So you need to get a hold of your congresspeople and your senators and all them and tell them that you do not want this bill passed, because if it does, that means they'll take all the vitamins off the shelves. They'll take all of the herbs, natural herbs that actually do balance people, off the shelves and make it, quote, illegal, so that the pharmaceutical companies can then come in and give you more drugs. Hey, hey, and make a lot of money. And the human population gets sicker and sicker as time goes on, because they don't know what these drugs will do to our systems. And most of those drugs are synthetics, and our system is not made for synthetics. That's why we have so many adverse effects to it, and maybe not right away, but in the long run, like your liver usually gets shot, you know, and then everybody's going to get sick. So those are some of the things that people could do, is just try to help themselves by, first of all, being happy inside. You're alive. You're breathing. Be happy about that, you know. Showing love to other people. Those kind of things are real, real important. The children of today, they come here with total, total love. That's all they know until it is taken away. Like some of the things that was playing before I came on, you know, you got to wake up, folks, because even though you may not want to believe what David Icke might say or somebody else might say or even what I might say, you're seeing it. Just open your eyes and look around and see who's getting rich and who's getting poor. That'll tell you a lot just by looking at that. You know, we need to take back our rights. How many people out there really believe that we still have constitutional rights?
Well, it's
think about, huh?
We have them. They're just being infringed upon relentlessly.
Totally. In every shape, way, and form.
I think that's because to face the challenges of the changes that are going to be occurring in the next 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, people are going to need to be playing with a full deck. And things like Codex Alimentarius, like you were just speaking about, and things like that, they make sure that you're not able to play with a full deck. They don't want you to be in your right mind, and they don't want you to be making clear-headed decisions at this time. They want you to be a baby, an adult child that has to watch 4 hours of TV just to be able to put up with their own life. They want you to be on the pharmaceuticals that put your brain to sleep. They want all that because they don't want you to be able to play with a full deck, because if you play with a full deck, you might just make it through the next 20 years.
Not might, you would.
Right.
That's the difference, Shereen. You know, that people have a very hard time looking at the world today and thinking that they're going to survive. I mean, there are many, many people without a job. There are many, many more jobs that are going to be closing. And it's all part of a ploy. And American people and a lot of people around the world know that. But they are afraid to do anything about it. And you see, I'm not afraid to say stuff, as you can tell. So it's time for people to wake up. You know, I have a saying that I tell a lot of people. And this is exactly, it's my own quote, and it goes like this. If you keep your head buried in the sand long enough, you are going to get your butt kicked really hard, seeing how that's the only thing that's up.
Right.
I like that. I like that. These coming disasters, let me ask you this. Could it be a pole shift? Is it anything like that, that's heading this way?
It can be a lot of things. The pole shift, yes. Again, the Earth has to rid itself, so it's going to do what it needs to do. There's other planets out there that's actually pulling on the poles. They call it the X planet. The government knows it's there. They're not really talking about it, but they know it's there. Scientists know it's there. It's a planet almost like Earth, almost identical, actually. And it is pulling on our axis, and it is going to make a shift. So that's part of it. But the other thing, I want everybody to think about this. Every time they send a spaceship up to outer space, they're shifting something on the ground, because all of that energy that is coming out of there, all that power that those, you know, the rockets are creating, they're shifting things. And if people don't understand that, they need to just take a globe out and take a pencil and push hard on one side of that globe and see what happens. It's going to spin. Well, the same thing's going on in everyday life. You know, they have all the jet streams going on, which are the chem streams. People think, oh, there's nothing wrong with those. But again, all of these things affect our atmosphere. They affect the way the Earth is going to react. And it affects the pole shift that's going to be going on.
Very true. I never thought about it that way. Yeah, I always thought, you know, the jets and things like that, it was too small to affect anything. But no, I mean, you have it in enough frequency. And sure enough, yeah, you're absolutely right. That's a really, really interesting perspective.
You know, I don't mean to interrupt. Back in the 60s and the 70s, they talked about how aerosol cans are thinning our ozone layer. Well, see, that's not really true. I mean, it may be a partial factor, but the biggest factor is all the jet planes that are up there, you know, burning the fuel, you know, putting it all out, polluting the entire, you know, atmosphere. And it's just been going on and on and on. And at some point in time, something has to give. And again, this planet isn't going to die. You know, it is going to make it. It's been here for thousands and thousands of years. We're not going to end. The world is not going to explode and fall apart on 2012. It's just a lot of things are going to come to a halt. And it's going to really baffle a lot of people. Like, at some point in time, probably all communications as far as internet, cell phones, and all that's going to go down. What do you think people are going to do if they can't text or make a phone call?
They'll freak out.
I think it's going to upset a few people. And then when those people get all upset and freak out, people around them are going to get all upset and freak out, and it's going to go on and on and on, which is just a chain reaction. And so everything is based upon this chain reaction, and it started many, many years ago. But, you know, I know that on your show, you guys do have people who talk about what our government is doing, and then you have the people out there that, like you said, Chris, they'd rather go have a beer and watch American Idol and live in denial. Well, the ones that live in denial probably won't make it. The ones who actually talk about it, willing to do something about it, they probably have a sure-in to make it through as long as they want.
Absolutely.
But the ones who still want to stay buried with their heads in the sand, they probably won't make the changes because they won't be able to tolerate it.
Absolutely. You brought up Nibiru, Planet X. I'm still not sure if that's something that's true or not. I mean, you have so many different sources. What can you tell us about Nibiru?
Well, what I've heard, because I can't prove anything, but what I have heard is that, yes, there is the Nibiru out there. It's been out there actually zooming around in its orbit for a long, long time, but it's getting closer. And as it gets closer, its pole is going to be opposite of ours, so it's going to pull our poles toward them. And as it does, between now and 2012, 2015, our planet is going to make a shift. And it's already kind of shifting already. We just don't know it yet. But because of the poles that are going to be pulling, it's going to make a pretty big shift, which will create a lot more nasty, nasty weather. And it will create different effects on the people, because any kind of energy shift affects the human being. But we don't realize that. Like, there are people out there that if the Earth shifts just a teeny, teeny part of a degree, they get all uptight and all nervous, and they don't even know why. But it's because of that energy shift, and that's what Nibiru is supposed to be doing, which will also create some of the disastrous weathers that we are supposed to be, you know, having as we get closer to 2012.
That is true. Everything that they say about Nibiru is happening as far as Earth changes. Even the Greeks, the ancient Greeks, used to call it the Nemesis. There were many cultures. The only one that I don't remember talking about it was the Romans, and they only lasted 1,000 years. But its orbit is supposed to come through, what is it, every 3,600 years?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's about right. And so it's time, basically. You know, we're living in a very, I don't want to say turbulent time, because that's only partially true. We are living in a very exciting time, because we are going to see changes that we've never, ever, ever in our history seen before on this planet. And again, that's why a lot of people are probably going to freak out and not make it, because they won't be able to tolerate the different energies that are going to be, you know, coming in actually for good, but it's not going to feel like that because it's so different. So this time frame is so different than a lot of other time frames, although, you know, the Earth has done changes before, but this time frame is different because there are more people who are becoming enlightened in this time frame than in a long, long time. You know, and not, I'm not knocking, you know, all those other civilizations, but this time here, the children that are here, they're so enlightened. A lot of the adults are beginning to be very enlightened. Again, the ones that don't want to become enlightened, the ones who want to laugh at the show and go have a beer and watch American Idol, well, again, you got to understand they're probably not going to make it. And in a way, it's okay that not everybody makes it, because this planet's already very much overly populated, and we are taking away a lot of its natural resources that could sustain us forever if we just didn't screw it up.
Oh, it's funny that you mentioned that. We were driving around the other day, and it was just packed. And we're like, oh, my God, there's just so many people in the world. And, you know, I hate to play devil's advocate here for a moment, but this coming Nibiru and things like that, do you think that this New World Order is just basically there to try to take control after this disaster? Do they know there's a disaster coming? There's nothing anybody can do about it. So this is their, what's the term, contingency plan?
They have a very big contingency plan and have had for a very long time, is why they keep so many things a secret and under wrap. Because, see, the more afraid and the more in fear that they make the people, the more they're going to be able to control them. You know, there's people like yourselves and myself who aren't about to be controlled. And there's many other people out there like us. They're not quite standing up just yet, but they will. Because regardless of what the government thinks, there are a lot of people who really kind of know the truth. And they are going to come forth, which will help as the planet does start to make its shift. And that's real, real important to know.
I see 2012-ish, that around that area, as being kind of the death of the ego as well. The mm-hmm. collective ego is going to fade away because we won't need it anymore. Terrence McKenna used to talk about the ego a lot and say that it was basically the cancer in our brain that causes mm-hmm. us to be so hateful towards each other, to do horrible things to each other. And it's consciousness, expansion of consciousness, that achieves peace and love and harmony. It's not the ego that does that. And so, and also Michael Sarian, we had him on a couple months ago, and he was saying the exact same thing. You know, whenever people talk about, you know, they see horrible things happening in their dreams, that's usually their ego that's that's going through that. And so I think a big problem that people are facing is the death of the ego, which is what's going to happen. And they don't like that, of course. Nobody likes to lose their ego, but anybody who's ever used a psychedelic can tell you losing your ego is probably the best thing they've ever done.
Well, the world is built on stroking the ego, inflating the ego. And that's exactly
masculine dominance.
Yeah. And that was the hardest thing for me to do, is lose that ego. And I know we were talking about this the other day, too. What advice would you give people to lose that ego?
Well, first of all, they have to admit that they have it. And that's a big, big power struggle with a lot of people, because they don't want to admit that they have an ego, because we've been raised that, man, you don't want to have an ego. That's bad. So a lot of the egos that have been kind of hidden and under wrap for a long time tend to come out when they themselves feel very threatened. So in order to lose the ego, they have to really go to the right side of their brain to do the thinking, because ego comes from the left side of the brain. And so if they could just go to the right side of the brain, in other words, think on the positive side, think about how great things are, you know, think about not only how great you are yourself, because there's ego and then there's ego, okay? I mean, everybody has to have a little bit of ego to really be who they are, because it's kind of your personality, but you don't have to have the ego like what we're seeing right now. So if they could just go inward, because this really is not an outside job. I mean, we talked about that before. This is not an outside job. This is an inward job. You have to go inside. You have to know who you are. You have to like who you are. You have to love who you are. You have to be very, very secure with who you are. When you have that, you don't have ego, not the kind of ego that we're seeing. You know, it's a knowing. It's not an ego. You know, I've been told many, many times, man, Nancy, you have a big ego. Well, no, I just kind of know who I am, you know, and a lot of people around me finally understand that. But the ones who don't know me look at me and go, man, listen to her talk. She thinks she knows so much. And that's not it, folks. It's just that everything is being shown. And the sooner you open your mind, that right side of your brain, the sooner that ego gets out of the way. And that self-fulfillment, that self-security all can come out then. And then you won't have that in your way. And the world can be a better place.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, we are speaking with Nancy Wallace. Her websites are nancypsychicresources.com. And this is Truth Frequency with Chris Chio and Cherie. We'll be right back in just a few minutes.
Truth Frequency, ladies and gentlemen. This is Chris Geo, and I'm joined as always by my lovely co-host, Cherie. And we are speaking with Nancy Wallace from NancyPsychicResources.com and talking about 2012, Nibiru, and how we can all love each other. Because, you know, when it comes down to it, we really did all have the same parents at one point in time. What parents those are, that's, you know, kind of questionable, because some people believe that we came from aliens from Nibiru. Some people believe we came from Adam and Eve. So I'd really like to get Nancy's take on it. Nancy, what do you think were the origins of man?
I personally believe that we're alien ETs, because here's a really thought-provoking question, and this is especially for the ones who are very religious. If we all came from Adam and Eve, that means every single one of us are living in incest.
Absolutely.
And so for the people to accept that, that's going to blow their mind. If they want to believe that there was this person who gave up a rib to create the woman, and that created millions of people in the world, well, we all are living in incest.
Okay. Back to 2012, you said that everything's going to happen in 2010. What?
Well, it's starting.
It's starting in 2010. Now. Okay.
Yeah, it's starting now.
So what are we going to be seeing in the next few years?
Well, you're still going to see a lot of the earth changes. There's going to be more earthquakes. There's going to be stronger storms that come in. There are probably going to be a lot stronger winds that come in, a lot of solar flares that hit us. You know, a lot of different weather disasters that we really cannot control. Although, I don't know, there's a group out there that seem to think that our wonderful government is the one that created the Haiti earthquake. That's pretty, it's called HARP. If you want to look it up, it's HARP, H-A-R-R-P. And it's got some pretty good information with that. So more natural disasters like that. You know, the Edgar Cayce map that he did a long, long time ago when he was kind of channeling, and Michael Scallion's map that he did, the future map of the world. And Michael Scallion, I don't know if people know who he is, but not only is he a psychic, but he's also a scientist. And he put the two maps together, and they're almost identical. I think in Africa, instead of it breaking apart diagonally with whatever, it's going to break apart, you know, across the middle a couple of times. But the same changes that they both showed, whether it was Edgar Cayce's channeling or Michael Scallion's doing it according to scientific studies, it still shows the world breaking up in different parts. And so a lot of land will probably go underwater, and it will break up. The United States will probably, not between now and 2012, but sometime between probably now and 2017, will break up into a lot of little islands. And since New Orleans and all those are already underwater, chances are they're not going to be here. So they can look up those maps. I mean, they don't have to believe what I'm telling them, but those are some of the things that I saw as a child, but didn't know what I was seeing until somebody brought me the map and said, hey, Nancy, you need to look at this because this is what you're describing. And I thought, yeah, I've seen that before. Didn't know what it was at the moment. But after I took a look at both those maps, I thought, that's what my angel showed me when I was 6 through 12. You know, so, you know, there's a lot of things that's going to be changing. And it's not that it has to be totally, totally disastrous. I want people to understand that. Because there's so many people are doing the gloom and doom thing, that if you want to believe doom and gloom, you're going to get doom and gloom. But if you believe it as a spiritual awakening, you know, a transition, you know, learning how to love again, those are all good things. Those aren't bad things. So people need to know that.
Absolutely. You know, recently that movie Avatar came out, and the way that I saw it was, that's the way we can be if we get back in touch with the earth, if we get back in touch with ourselves, and we can live in harmony with everything. A lot of people were demonizing it, saying it was Gaia worship, it was New World Order propaganda to live in a digital world or some kind of garbage like that. Have you heard that kind of rhetoric?
I hear many, many things. and I just truly, so you know, let a lot of them just roll off my back because, again, I know what my angels have shown me. And it makes a difference because I have followed their basically teaching to keep my life kind of where it needs to be. And, but I'm human like everybody else. So, I mean, you still have to learn. You know, even though I have my angels telling me you don't want to do that, I kind of go, oh, yeah, I do. And they go, no, you don't. And I go, oh, yeah, I do. And then when I do it, I kind of get that let's call it visual slap to let me know that I probably shouldn't have done what I did. But, you know, I'm human, and so, you know, it's okay. It just helps you learn a little bit better. But it's real important that people understand that they are going to hear many, many things. And if they just go into their heart and they listen to what I call the heart smart part, they will really be okay. They will understand, and they will get it right. But if they keep, you know, listening to all that stuff and stay in the left brain, which is all logic and got to have reasons for this and reasons for that, they're going to falter here. You know, so that heart smart part is so, so important for what's coming now. I mean, you just have no idea.
It really is. It really is. I find when I follow logic, a lot of times if I go against what's in the heart, I wind up getting in trouble. Not in trouble, but I mean, I wound up in bad situations or things don't go exactly like they should. I can look back on the situation and go, oh, you know what? If I would have done this differently, all of these events taking place after that would have been unfolded differently. So yeah, that's definitely advice that I give to people. I'm thinking about making a big move, as I was telling you offline, and I think I'm going to follow my heart with that one. Per your advice.
Yeah, I really think that you need to, because if you don't, you're not going to know. The other thing I was going to tell you guys is, now when are you, now you're talking about going in May, is that right?
May, June sometime then.
May, June, okay. In May, if you guys want, both you and Cherie, you guys need to come on one of my shows, and we'll do an interview on you guys so that people kind of get to know who you are too, because when you're interviewing, you don't really get to say a whole bunch, but when you're being interviewed, you get to say a lot more. So we'll have to set that up, okay?
Okay.
Sounds great.
There's somebody in the chat room who's asking if they can call in and get a little mini reading. Would you be up for that?
Sure.
Okay.
Oh, sure.
Let's see. The call-in lines are brand new, so I'm going to have to look them up. 218. You know, this is still loading. Anyways, guys, you can check out the caller lines right on the show page where you're listening at. We've got the caller lines right up there. I'm trying to get in here. Bear with me, please. Here it is. 218-862-3807. That's 218-862-3807, and it's access code 1776. Let's see. Cherie, why don't you take the conversation from here?
Well, I think that you're right. I think that going back to what we were saying earlier about our sense of self, I think that has a lot to do with the way we treat others and the way we look at the world. We come into this world as spotless, you know, as spotless beings who have nothing but love to share with others. But then it's through growing up and being hurt by other people that we develop that ego that keeps us suppressed. And I think if we can get rid of that, then everything will be fine. Not everything will be fine, but I mean, we can at least start to work on getting humanity where it needs to be.
Yeah, I really agree with you, Cherie. I mean, people, you know, here, I'm going to give you a perfect example. It's probably going to aggravate everybody, but down the road, I'm sure they'll understand. When I was a kid, I used to go to church. But for the life of me, I couldn't figure out what these people were doing. Because at 6 years old, I told my mom I wasn't going to go to church anymore. And we argued about it. And finally, she asked me why not. I said, because I don't understand how people can just be downright mean and nasty to each other for, say, Monday through Saturday. And then Sunday, they put on a nice outfit. They go sit in church, and they're just perfect people who just act so nice and, you know, believe so much. And then they walk out of that church, and it starts all over the next day with them being really nasty. So I refused to go to church because I didn't get it.
Well, that's
and
what
I didn't agree with it.
That's what organized religion does. It's like a ticket, so you can be an a-hole all week and then go to church. And I'm sorry, God, and that's it. Oh, I deal with it a lot here in my real life, so in my day-to-day life. Let's go ahead and take a caller. Caller 928, you're on the air with Nancy Wallace.
Doing? Thanks for taking my call.
Hi, caller.
Nancy, actually, you had given me a reading, I think it was the last time you were, and it was spot on, I must tell you, and I just wanted to see if you might be able to give me a little peek inside the future.
Okay. Well, your very first card was really kind of neat, is your wish card, which means whatever you're wishing for from your heart, not your head, from your heart, actually you're going to be getting. Your power level, your energy level, you got to make sure you keep up. No matter how many people try to drag it down, keep it up. Then you're coming up with the Wheel of Fortune, which is completion of good things coming your way. But, you know, that stress is trying to work in, so kind of keep the stress away. Don't overthink, because when people overthink, they tend to worry, get stressed, and exactly what they're worrying about tends to happen. So you're coming up with some really good lifestyle changes coming for yourself. Good choices, good decisions now, and the Sun, which is the second best card in the deck. So your cards look really pretty good. Just don't overthink, okay?
Sounds like me, but thank you very much, Nancy. That's great. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
We have a couple of other callers, but I'm sorry, guys. We are running out of time. We're going to have Brooks Agnew come on. He is the scientist who was going to lead the North Pole expedition. I don't know what happened with that, but we're going to find out if the Earth was hollow. And real quick, before we let you go, Nancy, what do you think about the hollow Earth theory?
I think there's so many theories that are going to be coming out, and people will be quite surprised at what's being proven, not just the hollow part, because I think it probably is. But also all of the UFOs, ETs, all those things coming in, they're all going to be coming in now, and we just have to stay open and allow it.
Do you think these ETs are coming from inside of the Earth?
Well, they're coming all to the Earth.
Okay.
Some of them already have bases here on the Earth.
Right. I think David Icke's new book is about moon bases.
Yeah.
Have you read about that? Yeah.
Do you think they're benevolent or malevolent?
I think they're a little bit of both.
They're just like people, huh?
Yeah, they are. That could be a good thing or a bad thing, but yeah, they're both. They're both.
And one more time, how can people reach you?
They can call me at 630-941-6816, or they can go to my website, which is Nancy's, that's with an S, psychicresources.com. They can find out about my 501c3, A Child's Miracle Mind, Inc., at www.childsmiraclemind.org, and talks about the School of Now, which is the school that's going to be here to help these children. And I'd like to thank you guys for having me on again.
Oh, thank you for coming on. You're welcome anytime.
Thank you, Nancy.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Nancy Wallace. We will be right back. This is Truth Frequency with Chris and Cherie, and we're going to have Dr. Brooks Agnew join us to talk about the Hollow Earth 2012 and Higher Consciousness.
Planet Earth is a super living organism. Since the dawn of time, ancient cultures have understood that every living creature has a spirit, a life force which animates the physical body. Just as every living animal has a spirit, so too does planet Earth. Great scientists such as Sir Isaac Newton and Sir Oliver Lodge recognized the existence of a spiritual domain which surrounds the planet. They called this domain the ether.
A vibrational change going on within the Earth's energy field, and this is affecting weather patterns. It's like a shift, and as it shifts, of course, weather being you really got to see a thunderstorm. You can see that weather is just an obvious expression of energy. So if the Earth's energy field is changing in its vibrational state and making a shift,
in recent times, an evil group of people who communicate with the spirits of Baphomets and demons have been destroying the very spirit of planet Earth. This global network of black magicians, Satanists, Luciferians, and occultists are called the Illuminati.
Hey, It is written, many are called, but few are chosen. I like to think of it a little differently. Many are called, but few choose. I've been chosen to lead the North Pole Inner Earth Expedition. My name is Brooks Agnew, and I choose to start here. Mount Shasta, at 9,000 feet, shrouded in the mists of mystery. To begin what may be the greatest geological expedition in the history of the world. To discover if the Earth is hollow or not. Join us.
And welcome back to Truth Frequency, ladies and gentlemen. This is your host, Chris Geo, and I'm joined, as always, by my lovely co-host, Cherie. And joining us on the line, we have Dr. Brooks Agnew. He is a teacher, scientist, engineer, talk show host on X2 Radio, and an Earth Explorer. It's a pleasure having him on the show, and I'm really looking forward to discussing 2012, The Hollow Earth, and Higher Consciousness with Dr. Agnew. Dr. Agnew, do we have you on the line?
Yes, you do. Good evening.
Good evening, sir. It's a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure.
You know, first, you know, I have to say that, I mean, you remind me of a modern-day Professor Challenger. I mean, I don't know if you've heard that before, but maybe even a modern-day Galileo. I first heard of your work on Coast to Coast. I heard you talking about the Ark of Millions of Years. And then I heard you talking about the North Pole Expedition when I first heard about the Hollow Earth. And then talking about Kundalini meditation. So, I mean, there's so much that I want to get into. But I guess first and foremost, can you give our listeners a little background about who you are?
Oh, boy, who I am. Well, I'm just an ordinary guy walking down the street eating cookies and drinking milk. But I do have an amazing curiosity, and that has caused me to get a bachelor's degree in chemistry and eventually a PhD in physics, and I have followed my dream almost as far as I can. Hopefully there's more left to it. And what I've discovered is that the act of discovery, the process of discovery, is the most exciting thing about mortal life that I enjoy the most. And so it just looks like I'm doing a lot. I think I'm just really busy.
I completely agree. I mean, it seems like this whole world is meant to be a veil to hide all of the secrets, and I want to know the secrets. That's why I get on the radio show and interview great people, great minds like yourself, because I want to know the secrets of the world. But as a doctor and a scientist, how do your colleagues feel about this? Do you get a lot of support from this? Because, I mean, I would imagine that mainstream media would think about some of these things like Kundalini meditation and the Hollow Earth to be preposterous theories.
Well, you would be surprised. The last couple of years, there have been mainstream universities like Johns Hopkins, Washington University, Harvard, even MIT, that have really made some inroads in releasing what I consider to be major papers in paranormal science. Things like Hollow Earth, things like other dimensions, things like trans-dimensional travel, and even things like chakras in the human body. I'm really amazed at how mainstream science is looking like it's taking a left-hand turn, kind of like NASCAR. And this is what I attribute it to. You know, for about 30 years of my early career, institutional education was the rule. It mattered a whole lot what university you went to and what professor you studied under and what textbook you used and where you published and how often you were recognized in your professional societies. Since the advent of the Internet, and I'm going to say 1996, 1997, is when the Internet just began to be available to most households, when cable modems became fairly popular. By the year 2000, most households had some kind of Internet connection. Now, what this did is it put great knowledge, high-end, leading-edge, out in the front of most technologies, right in the hands of everyone. Now, when you do that, you're going to put knowledge in the hands of very, very intelligent people. and some of them may only be 12 or 14 years old. They are not in college. They're not schooled by a professor. They're not taught the old school or the old ways. They're picking up raw knowledge, and they're applying it with a new mind. And what has happened is institutional education is losing its grip on what is and is not mainstream. And so the mainstream has now flooded the banks, and now it's well up into the flatlands. And I'm telling you, the earth is changing right before our eyes because of it.
Well, thank God for that. You know, I often say that this kind of knowledge was only privileged to the really, really wealthy who had huge libraries in their basements, you know, those mansions with the huge libraries. And now it's at the tip of everybody's fingertips. And I think it's the apocalypse. It really is. If you look at the Greek word apocalypse, it means the great revealing. And so this is really the great revealing.
It really is. And one of the remarkable things is, you know, when you get a PhD, it means you know a whole lot about very little. In fact, you know a whole lot about a fraction of very little. But if you're a curious person and you're a good reader and you stay after it, you know, my proctor when I was going through graduate school told me that if I would read 4 books in my field a year after I got my degree, every 4 years, it would be the equivalent of me getting another degree. Well, I took that challenge, except I read 40 books a year, and I did that for 10 years. So it makes a big difference on how well-rounded you are, how able you are to make transitory relationships between music and mathematics, architecture and poetry, dynamics and statics. And this is what's really made the genre of paranormal science so interesting and so fascinating to so many people.
It's like a renaissance, isn't it? It's like a new renaissance of information and a renaissance of learning.
It really is a renaissance. And now you're getting more and more, you're getting renaissance people. People that have multiple skills in multiple disciplines, and they're really able to change their communities, their states, and their countries, and it's going to change the planet.
I hope so, because it looks like we're heading for a very bad place if we don't get off of American Idol, if we don't get out of our iPods and start absorbing some of this knowledge, because it seems like the average American, the average human being, they're stuck in the matrix. But, you know, speaking of changes, there's a lot of Earth changes coming to pass right now. What is your take on that? I mean, are we seeing a pole shift? I know the poles have shifted in the past. What's going on with all these earth changes and earthquakes and devastation everywhere?
Well, it's a matter of cause and effect, I think. The causes are multiple in nature. The major one right now, I think, is that our solar system is entering a region of space that it goes into periodically, but every fourth precession, every 104,000 years, our planet ends up in a very precarious position where we are exposed to very high energy particles, very high energy cosmic radiation, and a very powerful galactic wind. When that happens, new energy starts bombarding all the planets in the solar system. And we see that. All the planets in the solar system are warming. Saturn's atmospheric pressure has gone up 30% in the last 18 years. Now, that is cataclysmic.
Well, that's because of our SUVs, though, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm sure. The Earth, if you just look at the statistics, the Earth in the last 25 years has seen an incredible increase in frequency and intensity of earthquakes, volcanoes, hurricanes, tsunamis, and we're really beginning to see those changes accelerate. Just in the last month, we have had 3 earthquakes over 7.0 on the Richter scale, and we've also increased the number of
looks like we lost him. Ladies and gentlemen, let's take a quick break. And this is Truth Frequency with Chris Gio and Cherie. And we'll be right back in just a few minutes.
From this wider perspective, so much of what we do to each other must have the rest of creation shaking their heads in disbelief. The fact is that someone born in the United States is not more special than someone born in Mexico. Someone born in London is not more special than someone born in Liverpool. Someone who is white is not more special than someone who is black. They're just vehicles for the consciousness to experience. If you go down to the seashore and you pick up a droplet of water in your hand, how can anyone say that that droplet is any more or less special than all the other billions and trillions of droplets you see in the ocean before you? It's the perfect environmental and human assassin. It insists every year that we take more from the earth even quicker, turn it into even more things, sell even more things, consume even more things, throw away even more things, to worship the real god of the modern world, economic growth. How can you buy or sell the sky? We do not own the freshness of the air or the sparkle on the water. How then can you buy them from us? Every part of the earth is sacred to my people, holy in their memory and experience. We know the white man does not understand our ways. He's a stranger who comes in the night and takes from the land whatever he needs. The earth is not his friend, but his enemy. And when he's conquered it, he moves on. He kidnaps the earth and his children. His appetite will devour the earth and leave behind a desert. If the beasts were gone, we would die from a great loneliness of the spirit. For whatever befalls the earth, befalls the children of the earth.
Glory is near.
And welcome back to Truth Frequency, ladies and gentlemen. This is your host, Chris Gio, and I'm joined as always by my lovely co-host, Cherie. And we are speaking with Dr. Brooks Agnew, and we do apologize for the technical difficulties. I just want to say that's what you get when you work with a budget of zero. but you know what? We just got picked up by American Freedom Radio. They are a huge network broadcasting on AM and FM. So our Saturday show starting on March 27th will be broadcasted from American Freedom Radio. So check that out. Right now I'm running the board. I'm running the phones. I'm running everything myself. So thank you for bearing with us. I think we have Dr. Agnew back on the line. Do we have you there?
Yes, I'm back.
Excellent, okay. Excellent. You know, it was that clip that I just played was from David Icke, and he was talking about the shamans and something that he said. And it's amazing how the mainstream science is just catching up with what the shamans were saying thousands of years ago.
Well, it is. And mainstream science, for lack of a better word, we just call it religiosity. They have their own high priest. They have their own Bible. They have their own rituals and their own dogma that suppresses the advent of new knowledge and insight. And there is still a habitual, almost ritualistic method in which most science, most mainstream science, throws out data on a regular basis because it doesn't match their hypothesis.
That can be found with the seismic readings of the tectonic plates, correct?
It could. You know, the USGS, I've got to commend them because it took a tremendous amount of investment and a tremendous amount of study and coordination to get all of the USGS stations around the planet to talk to one another in real time. This took a great designing and a great amount of work. Now, that being said, when all the information comes in and it creates a sort of CAT scan of the Earth when we have a large earthquake, it just makes a seismogram. There's no analytical work that goes on unless a university happens to get a grant and goes through several hundred thousand of these seismograms and begins to put together a model. And that's exactly what happened when Dr. Y Sessions of Washington University took several of his grad students. They went through 600,000 seismograms that had been generated by the USGS. And when they got through modeling it, this is what they published. They discovered another ocean underneath the Atlantic Ocean. They were picking up the damping waves of waves crashing against the shore on the inside of the Earth.
Wow. I didn't know that. I thought when they were doing the seismic readings, they were just finding blank spaces and just saying, oh, well, that's just glitches in the machines. I didn't realize that they actually picked up an ocean down there.
Well, they didn't. What happened was you have to take the 600,000 seismograms that are done through these series of earthquakes, looking from the atolls in the South Pacific to the Northwest to Manila to South America, where these points of vibration occur, these slippages in the tectonic plates, they sort of thump the earth like a CAT scan does your knee when you go have an exam, and they look at the earth from several different angles. Now, the seismograms that are normally generated, they don't do that. They only look from one angle at a time. And what it shows, sure, it shows a thick crust of about 800 or 900 miles thick. It shows a void. And then we see waves showing up on the other side of the planet. Now, what they've done is they've sort of forced it into a model which looks like a giant molten ball with continents floating around on the surface of it like cornflakes in a bowl of milk. And they forced the data to fit that kind of model. In order to do that, they have to draw a lot of dotted lines, which means they make a lot of assumptions in their graphs. But if you don't make the assumptions and you just take the data for what it is and you look at it from numerous points of view, that is to say numerous points of origin for the earthquakes, you begin to get a very different picture of the Earth. And that's where hollow Earth theory really got a shot in the arm. It started with Edmund Halley in 1629. Mr. Gardner picked it up. He ended up dying in 1965 looking for, he caught pneumonia while he was looking for an opening in the Arctic regions. My great-great-grandfather discovered the North Magnetic Pole, Sir James Ross, in 1831. We had Admiral Byrd flying over the North Pole in 1926, the South Pole in 1929. You start pulling all of this data together, and you see vast disparities between the current school-taught version of what Earth looks like on the inside and hollow Earth theory. The amazing thing is nobody has ever gone above the Arctic Circle by sea looking for this opening. It's never been done. That's why we put the expedition together.
Well, that would shake the whole foundation of just the conventional thinking if we found out that the Earth was hollow.
Oh, I think the foundation's already been shaken. What we're about to do is rip the roof off and look down inside.
Excellent. That's why I was comparing you to Professor Challenger. What happened? I would imagine that you were railroaded over and over and over again. If this is such a huge secret that they're trying to keep under wraps, I would imagine that it's just difficult to pull off an expedition like this. What were some of the obstacles that you've been experiencing so far?
Well, the main obstacle, of course, is the money. There's only one ship on planet Earth that's civilian that can make this expedition. It is owned by the Russians. The Russians control the international waters above the Siberian Islands. No other ship on Earth can make this trip. The trip, just the charter, just the 15-day charter, costs really close to $2 million. This is what stops everyone from taking this expedition. Now, you can take a pleasure cruise to the North Pole. You can skirt the Northwest Passage, and you can take an icebreaker, and you can go to the exact a geomagnetic North Pole of the Earth. But that's not where the opening is reported to be. The opening is reported to be 300 to 400 miles away from that in an area that's been impassable for over 200,000 years. My ancestor nearly died the first time, and the second time he did discover the North Magnetic Pole off San Josef Islands. But this area only opened up for the first time by sea in the year 2007. So it has not been open very long, and it takes a tremendous amount of effort to get investors together to fund an expedition that only promises to make a film, a documentary of this expedition. Now, on the downside, we might just see whales and ice, but I still think it would be as interesting as every documentary put together on Everest. But on the outside, on the upside, there's this amazing Indiana Jones aspect to the expedition. There are three things that really seem to turn people around. One, of course, is that we might discover an opening into the Earth. That might be in the form of a large fissure in the ocean floor through which seawater from inside the Earth mixes with our ocean. It could be a hole 100 miles across that we can actually fly over with a helicopter and look down inside the Earth at low altitude. There are other aspects to it. If there is a void in the center of the Earth, I guarantee you, absolutely no doubt whatsoever, there will be life there. Now, it might be microbial. It might be more complex. In fact, if it's substantial enough, there might be civilizations of beings living there. And if that's the case, and many people suspect that it is, then as a scientist, with no supply mission, no rescue mission, we have to be prepared to gather that data, which means the real mission is to put the ship with the right people and the right consciousness in the right place so that maybe the gate will open and they will come to us.
So this would put you kind of on the same level as Christopher Columbus exploring the New World.
It would. You know, when Christopher Columbus was trying to sail the ocean, he needed a map. His father-in-law, who was a Templar, had a hand-me-down map that ostensibly had the Western world mapped on it. That's why Christopher Columbus knew exactly where he was going, and he didn't get lost. But that means that people prior to Christopher Columbus had already sailed the globe and knew what was out there. It was only the leadership, the religious/scientific leadership of the day, that forbade men from sailing beyond eyesight of the shore. They sowed a myth that the planet was flat, and if you sailed too far out there, you're going to fall off the edge of the world. Well, sailors before this age knew that was utter nonsense. But somewhere along the way, that knowledge was lost. It was suppressed. It was destroyed by the leadership of the world. They wanted to keep people within eyesight of their own shore.
Well, absolutely. I mean, they even imprisoned Galileo for saying that the Earth was round.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
All he wanted them to do was look through his eyepiece and see that the planets were going around the Earth. They could see the sun going across the face of the, or the stars going across the face of his telescope, but they wouldn't even look through the eyepiece. Believe it or not, we have a lot of priests just like that in science today.
Well, isn't it true that satellite images of the North Pole are not made available to the public?
Well, it is true. In February of 2006, the NOAA and EUMETSAT, these are the two big satellite networks of the free world, made a treaty, and they issued what's called the Data Denial Act. This is an act that denies real-time data from satellites in the form of pictures or images to the public during times of conflict or war. There are no publicly available images of the poles on the net, period. There are some stitched pictures that are made from polar satellites, but you can't use these because there are several hundred miles at each pole where the pictures are stitched together, where there's no data. It's just black.
Well, if it was for the purpose of keeping information safe in a time of war, why would they be doing that for the poles? I mean, if they're uninhabited, there's really no harm in letting us see them.
Well, you would think so, but the Department of Defense does not want high-resolution images of the pole made available to the public because it could be fed into cruise missiles and used to drive low-altitude missiles over the poles and attack free countries from the north.
Oh, okay.
I see. Okay.
That makes sense.
If you look at Google Earth, though, it's also the same. At one point in time, it was all ice. Now it's all water. And you know what's funny is if you really zoom in down there, you can see a little hole in it. But I'm sure that's just a glitch from the graphic. There's a bunch
of... Well, one thing people need to know about Google Earth, everything above the 60th parallel is animated.
Hmm.
Isn't there a... another entrance in Tibet, though? Don't the monks guard an entrance to the center of the earth?
I went to Tibet in April of 2008. I spent 2 weeks there in a four-wheel drive going over the upper Tibetan plateau from Lhasa all the way down to Nepal through the Ring of Power. I visited monasteries that were at the top of dry rivers that you wouldn't be even able to see in the summertime up there. I talked to hundreds of monks. I had a great guide who was bilingual. I found a lot of evidence that they had a lot of knowledge of stellar formations, of galactic formations. But in my inquiries about a hollow earth, or an inner earth, or an opening into the inner earth, the only thing they talked about was Shambhala, and it was mythical to them. They had no evidence of anything in this dimension that led to an inner earth.
Hmm. What are some of the other legends of the hollow earth that you can share for our listeners?
Well, one is that there is an opening on Mount Shasta. I went there 5 times. The intro that you played at the opening of your program, I was at 9,000 feet on Shasta during my third trip there. I had been all over the mountain. I'd been over it with guides and without guides, and there's no opening into the inner earth. Now, there are channelers who believe there's a city called Telos that's underneath Shasta, and frankly, they've made a very good business bringing tourists in and telling them these stories. But there is no opening on Mount Shasta. The other legend is that there was an opening in Mammoth Cave. So I went to Mammoth Cave. I spent a year going in and out of that cave, talking to the guides, taking multiple trips down multiple caves. The deepest section ever found at the bottom levels of Mammoth Cave is 385 feet down. If you're going to walk into the inner earth, the way it says in the book Edadorfa, you're going to have to walk 900 miles straight down. That's if you fell down a bottomless pit. But if you walked, you're talking a trip of about 2,500 miles of walking. There's no water. There's no light. There are no supplies. It's virtually impossible to walk into the inner earth from the surface.
So if people were going to the inner earth way in ancient time, they would have to have some other means than just walking into it.
They would have to sail into it, which is why the polar openings were the most attractive to us, because a ship could take enough supplies to last for several days or a month on a trek down a canal going into the inner earth. It would be possible to do that. Now, we've spoken to Russian maritime sailors. These are boats that go for extended periods of time, 30 to 45 days at sea. They speak of a phenomenon where two ships are sailing side by side. This was very common in the wooden ship days, but they still do it today. And during the time that the ships are sailing side by side, about 8 to 10 miles apart, one of the ships will just disappear from sight for several hours, even a day. And then it will rise right back up and be visible again. What appears to be happening is there are places on the ocean where sea level is not sea level. Now, I spoke to a naval admiral. He's retired now, and they are aware of this. They call them oceanic depressions. Their theory is these are areas of very high gravity on the planet that's actually pulling the ocean down like a parabolic dish. Well, I thought about it for a while because I had several hours with this gentleman. And I said, let me put another theory by you. What about if it's a region of the crust of the Earth that has very low gravity? And it's actually the background gravity around this area that's pulling the ocean away from that area, just like the moon does when it pulls tides around the planet. And he put his hand on his chin and thought for a moment. He said, you know what? You might be right. There might be rings of areas on the planet where gravity is very low. And the ocean actually is drawn away from these areas, and that's why we have these oceanic depressions. Now, that became pretty fascinating to me, because what would cause an area of low gravity on the Earth except for a thin crust?
The center of gravity, according to the Hollow Earth thinking, is right in the middle of the crust, correct?
Yes. If we look at some of the very leading-edge cosmological ideas as to how planets actually form, that you have a giant accretion disk of dust. It may be, a light year across, or maybe smaller. And as it begins to collapse, it begins to spin, because space is kind of curved, and it's sort of like a water going down the bathtub. As the diameter gets smaller and smaller, the disk begins to spin faster and faster. Some of the outlying areas of the disk will collapse into planets, which means where this mass is coming together, you have to conserve momentum. It's a little like an ice skater drawing her arms in as she spins on the ice. When she draws her arms in, she spins faster and faster and faster. Well, as it turns out, planets reach three different stages of development. One is that they spin so fast that they explode and fly apart like asteroids all over the place. The second is that they get lopsided and they end up getting heavy on one side and spitting off a portion of themselves into a moon. We have an example of this in our own solar system. Mercury used to be a moon of Venus, and it became so unstable that it broke out into its own orbit, and now we have the first and second planets of our solar system. The third condition is sort of like the Goldilocks condition. It doesn't spin too fast. It doesn't spin too slow. What happens is the crust begins to crack, and it fills in with molten material and cools, and then the planet slows because the diameter begins getting larger and larger very slowly. Well, when you look at Earth from space, one of the things you notice right off is that all the continents fit together like a key in a lock. Now, not the shorelines, but the continental shelves of them do, somewhat out in the water a little bit. The interesting thing is that there was a theory called Gondwanaland, or Pangaea, where all of the masses of the Earth were on one side together. Well, this theory has been completely shot out of the water, because the other side of the land masses also fit together. What really makes sense is that the Earth was once one-third its present size. Now, if you shrink the Earth, what you find is that all the land masses fit together and you have a nice crust-covered planet. But if you expand the Earth to three times that original size, and you start filling in the gap with new soil, new dirt, new rock, as it were, then the ocean then fills in those low-lying areas, and you end up with a planet that looks just like ours. Well, if that was the case, then there would be a difference in age between the dry land upon which we stand and the sea floor over which we sail. And guess what? That's exactly what we see. The dry land, say in North Carolina or Colorado in the middle of South America, is about 4.5 billion years old, just as expected. But the oldest seafloor is only 70 million years old, and some of it's as young as 10 million years old. So now we see a lot of really solid geological data that proves that Earth is probably hollow.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. I'm trying to wrap my head around all of this. If a ship was to sail through the North Pole into the center of the Earth, into the middle of the Earth, how would that gravity affect? I mean, wouldn't it get to a point that gravity is just so intense and you're kind of pushing down on the most intense gravitational pulls on Earth?
Actually, that's not what happens. According to Newton, where mass accumulates, that's where gravity is the highest. Now, there are a couple newer theories of gravity, but we haven't tested them on the inside of the planet. Newton had two theories. One was called thin shell physics. And this is where, when you get inside of an infinitely thin circle, gravity cancels itself out all the way around, and you end up being weightless. Well, if that's the case, planets cannot form as solid balls. They have to form as hollow spheres. His second theory was called thick shell physics, and it was an extrapolation of thin shell physics by just saying a thick shell is an infinite number of layers of thin shells. Well, what really happens is we started putting empirical data together, and we found that Newton's theory was flawed. We drilled into the Earth 9 miles. That's the deepest hole on Earth, 9 miles. And we did not see a decrease in gravity whatsoever. 9 miles, if you look at a 900-mile thick crust, isn't even a scratch on the surface.
Right.
What really would happen if we sailed to an opening that was, say, 300 miles thick at the poles where it would be its thinnest, you would then sail around a turn and be sailing on the inside of the crust, just like you were sailing on the other side of the world. But the gravity would be less, about one-third less. So if you dropped a weight from a height on the inside of the Earth to the bottom of the inside of the crust, it would only fall at the rate of about 21 feet per second per second. Whereas on the surface, we all know that gravity accelerates at about 32 feet per second per second.
Absolutely amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, we are speaking with Brooks Agnew, Dr. Brooks Agnew, and we'll be right back. This is Truth Frequency with Chris Chio and Cherie, and tune in every Thursday, 7 p.m. Central Time.
When I was in the ayahuasca state, the opening line of this female voice was, "The only thing you really need to know is infinite love is the only truth. Everything else is illusion." I looked down at my arm and I realized that I could no longer define the boundaries of my body. Because the left brain's shutting down, it's not decoding reality in the way it normally does, and so other levels of reality are able to be perceived because the decoding process is not affecting them.
Land of Mountain.
Infinite love is the only truth.
Land of Dakini.
Everything else is illusion.
Land of Mountain, of Mountain.
And when I was in that ayahuasca state, I looked down at my arm and I realized that I could no longer define the boundaries of my body. I can't define where I begin and where I end. Because the atoms and the molecules of my arm blended with the atoms and molecules of the wall. And when I was in that ayahuasca state, and all I could detect was this energy. And I'm asking myself, what's wrong with me? What's going on? And in that moment, my brain chatter, my left hemisphere brain chatter, went totally silent. Just like someone took a remote control and pushed the mute button. When I was in the ayahuasca state, first I was shocked.
Land of mountain.
But then I was immediately captivated by the magnificence of energy around me.
Land of mountain.
And because I could no longer identify the boundaries of my body, I felt enormous and expansive. I felt at one with all the energy that was, and it was beautiful there. Imagine what it would be like to be totally disconnected from your brain chatter that connects you with the external world. So here I am in this space, and any stress that related to me, to my job, it was gone. And I felt lighter in my body. And imagine all of the relationships in the external world and the many stresses related to any of those, they were gone. A sense of peacefulness. See, all this stuff, all this stress, all this stuff that causes such grief and stops us from finding joy. It's all body computer stuff, not consciousness. When the colonial powers came into Africa, as everywhere else, they targeted the shaman and the carriers of the ancient knowledge and the ancient history. And in his words, they milked the minds of the shaman and then killed them. So to keep the knowledge alive, the shaman streams started to create their own secret societies with horrendous initiation rituals to make sure you really wanted the knowledge. And they carried it underground so it would survive. Because what the colonial powers wanted, in other words, these bloodlines behind the colonial powers, they wanted to destroy as much of the ancient knowledge as possible, because then they could impose their own version of history, which would wipe out what they didn't want people to know.
And welcome back to Truth Frequency. This is Chris Geo, and I'm joined as always by my lovely co-host, Cherie. And on the line, we have Dr. Brooks Agnew. We are discussing the Hollow Earth 2012 and higher consciousness. And we're kind of going a little bit out of order, because I'd like to discuss higher consciousness and how we can achieve higher levels of consciousness, because that's pretty much the point of the broadcast is, I believe if we want to change the world, the first thing we have to do is change ourselves. And I know that you're into Kundalini meditation and things like that. What would you tell our listeners to be able to achieve that state of higher consciousness?
Well, there's a lot to it. Can I lay a little bit of foundation work first?
Absolutely.
Okay, one of the things that we see in the universe, when we look out and we look at how things form, is we see a lot of chaos. That's kind of what we see in mortal life, too, here on this earth, when any biological sentient population is turned loose. We see a lot of chaos. But one of the things that we notice in space is that sometimes out of chaos, order seems to spontaneously develop. And we've studied that to try to figure out why in the world what would appear to be maximum entropy would organize itself and go to a minimum amount of entropy. Without any intelligence, without any outside influence, it appears, being forced upon it. What we found is that there's a natural resonance to things. And when systems are allowed to exist that are unnatural, they don't seem to survive. They self-destroy each other. It's sort of like noise-cancellation headphones. When you turn the little button on, you realize that the outside noise is diminished. This happens because the microphone on the outside of the headphones seems to pick up the outside noise, shifts it 90 degrees, and then plays it back over the speakers, right over the music or the movie that you're watching, and it cancels out that particular frequency of noise. Well, this is exactly what happens in nature, except sometimes the frequencies seem to line up. They resonate with one another. And when they do, they increase in energy. They increase in order. And sometimes matter is even created out of this vibration. Well, what was this ratio? How did this happen? What we discovered, actually, it was a mathematician named Fibonacci, who discovered that there was a natural increase, a process of increase in numbers that nature seemed to like. Honeybees did it. Sunflowers did it. Conch shells did it. Bacterial growth did it. These were what would normally be considered chaotic conditions seemed to have very high levels of order when they followed this Fibonacci sequence of increase. Now, most of your listeners might know this as 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. And what this means is you're taking two numbers and adding them together to get a third, and then the second and third to get a fourth, and the third and fourth to get a fifth, and so on. And usually we start from 0. It's like the alphabet. You recite it from A and B and C and so forth. What we discovered as I was writing this fourth book that's about to come out is that you can take any two numbers, unrelated numbers. In the book we use 75 and 216. One's odd, one's even. They're not multiples of each other. They're not divisors of each other. And you add them together and you get 291. Now, without going into a lot of math, what happens is in the normal Fibonacci sequence, when you get out about 10 or 12 iterations from zero, for instance, 34 and 55, if you took 34 and divide it into 55, you get 1.618. Now, this is a ratio that's called the golden mean. It's called phi. It is a ratio that nature likes. And when energies or shapes or directions take on this kind of ratio, they tend to build on one another. They tend to toward higher order. When we do this with our own consciousness, we tend toward higher order. We raise our own frequency. We begin to multiply our power with very small efforts done at exactly the right moment, at the right frequency. We can have tremendous effects on our environment. It's called being in the zone. It's called, you know, being lucky. It's called having everything go your way. We know what it feels like. We just haven't figured out how to get there on purpose. And so when it comes to raising higher consciousness, I discovered that it's actually a mathematical function. Because guess what happens when you take those two numbers that are unrelated and you start adding together in the Fibonacci sequence? When you get to the eighth iteration, you divide the seventh into the eighth, and you get 1.618 to 1, and it doesn't matter what two numbers you use. This was an absolute breakthrough when it comes to manipulating consciousness and working the power of abundance, this force which we call the Kundalini meditation. It is being able to take what feels like ordinary human energy and really mastering extraordinary power, even with a single person in a society. With this kind of power, we call it the X factor. These are people that are not particularly bright, not particularly good looking or strong or attractive in any way. But somehow when you drop that person into a society, the whole society begins to rise up. It's kind of like Jesus or Gandhi or Buddha or Confucius. They just have this effect on their surroundings. And there are thousands of people like this in every society, and now we know why.
Would that be considered like the Christ consciousness?
It is a Christ consciousness, especially when it gets to a certain frequency, because what happens is you're not just an individual out on a rock in the middle of space. No, no. your biological transducer, that thing which we call the mortal body, that thing with all the taste buds and the rods and cones and the eyes and the ability to sense vibration with the ears and feel all kinds of thermal energy with your skin, that biological transducer becomes amazingly attuned to the earth itself. The earth itself makes up the minerals and the water that we consume through the cornflakes, the peas and the carrots and the Snickers bars that we eat actually become part of our body. And our consciousness is resonating on the inside of this biological transducer, and we are then resonating with the earth itself. Now, when you can do this and fit into that grid of energy around the earth, you can reach this Christ consciousness.
And how do you achieve these states, though? Where would somebody begin?
I would say the best place to begin is a thorough form of meditation. Now, I personally use the Flower of Life meditation because I didn't want to spend years and years and years trying to master something where I'm hanging from fish hooks or something. I wanted something that I could get into a meditative state very quickly, because I don't have a lot of time to waste here. You know, we're about out of time on this planet. I don't have time to master this. I want something I can master very quickly. So I used the Flower of Life meditation. It was developed by Drun Vila Melchizedek. My favorite teacher is Maureen St. Germain. And I got good at it. And in a couple of years, I really got good at it. There are 17 breaths in the normal Merkava meditation. They speak of an 18th breath, but they don't teach it. And so I developed it on my own. I validated it with those two teachers, and they said it was correct, and it works. And we put it into this fourth book called Remembering the Future, and it works. It functions. So this is the very basic thing you have to do. Learn to meditate. Why? Because what it does, it quiets the noise down in your head. All those horns honking and bills you have to pay and personality stresses that you go through, they can be dropped down to a very low microwave hum.
The left brain.
When it is.
The left brain chatter.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The left brain chatter. And it allows you to listen to the universe. Because believe it or not, whether you're conscious or not, you are affecting the universe with your consciousness. But you don't know how you're affecting the universe unless you listen. And if you're going through life breaking glass all around you and not paying any attention, you're not going to hear anything. And if you can't hear, you won't know when you're supposed to move, when you're supposed to act, what door you're supposed to go through, what window you're supposed to go to. Now, I validated this after I figured out what we call the Phoenix sequence, this development of the Fibonacci energies in this way. And I decided, well, okay, if this theory is correct, then I should be able to go interview people who have really been successful, baseball players, golfers, real estate salesmen, investors, and I should be able to ask them a series of questions and find out if this is what is happening in their lives. I asked them, how many times did you try your profession before you really got good at it? Chris, they said 8. 8 times. It was the people that quit at 3 or 4 times their dream or their goal in life that didn't make it. They quit. They started over and over again with different ideas. If you stick with it and you listen to the universe, take that time to meditate and raise that energy up inside of you, you will be able to move at the right time, in the right way, and just like Nikola Tesla, making minute additions of energy, he could almost shake a bridge to the ground.
Amazing. You're giving me goosebumps here listening to that. What are your thoughts on ayahuasca and shaman rituals like that in order to achieve higher states of consciousness? Is that something to stay away from? Is that something to incorporate?
I think there are some rituals that are good in the sense that you reach a resonance. You know, even singing church hymns if you've sung enough of them, you realize they're all pretty much in the same key. They have the same chord progressions. And what happens when the human voices are blended in four-part harmony, you get an amazing feeling of elation. It's euphoric almost. And it's really brings what people call the spirit on, and it makes you feel reverence for the universe. Well, this also happens in Indian rituals, and it happens in chanting rituals, drumming rituals. It happens when you play the didgeridoo. This is natural, and it is to be utilized to its best potential. Now, that being said, you can get caught up in the ritual just for the ritual. If you don't believe me, go to a Catholic mass sometime.
Right.
Or go to a Freemason meeting or a Templars meeting. You'll see a lot of ritual, and you will feel nothing from it.
Absolutely. I was raised Greek Orthodox, and same with the Catholic Church. We'd go to the church, I'd feel absolutely nothing. I mean, it was an emptiness. It was a dryness. It's amazing that you mentioned that, and that's what I tell people. You know, you have to go with whatever feels right to you. But let me ask your take on this. A lot of these church ceremonies, frequencies, and things like that, it seems to me as though perhaps they're hypnotizing people at the same time. People who don't realize they're being tapped into a frequency like that, they're being tapped into it by the leader in order to control them. What are your thoughts
on
that?
You bring up a really good point. Because these energies are well known, and their effects on the human spirit are well known, they can also be manipulated. Now, here is the telltale where you can tell whether you're being manipulated and hypnotized, as it were, or whether you're rising to a higher and higher state. And that is the core of fear. If there is a message of fear in that gospel or in that message that's being taught, for instance, if you don't do what I tell you to do, you're going to hell.
That's my favorite.
Now, in the book, I have a billboard of a highway, a highway billboard. It says, when you die, where are you going to spend eternity? Well, Chris, I'm a little confused because I thought we were already in eternity. I thought we were about halfway through it, as a matter of fact. I didn't know it began when you died.
Absolutely.
So we're, I figured out.
We're infinite energy.
We've existed a long, long time.
We're infinite energy in the universe. We're all one. If we can all realize that we're all part of the universe never wastes anything. It's not going to waste energy. Then I think we can start treating people a lot better. But, you know, like I mentioned earlier in the broadcast, we're all stuck in the iPods and just hypnotized and brainwashed. When you approach somebody like that, how do you wake them up out of that? We ask every guest this because there's so many different ideas. How do we wake people up from that hypnotized state to realize that we are higher beings?
Well, I take them on a little time travel trip. That's what I do. I first of all, I ask them what their dream is, and sometimes they'll say something like, if it's women, they'll say something like, I want to marry a rich man and I want to live in a big house. And so I say, okay, what happens if you marry the rich man and he has a big house? Life is complete and you can die? I mean, you know, I want you to think about being something or doing something instead of having something. And once they realize that, wow, you're right, my whole dream is all wrapped around having, and they realize how empty it is, they have this aha moment. You know, I tell people I love to ride motorcycles, and somebody will say, well, where are you going? And I'll look at them so funny, like, well, I'm going riding. Yeah, I know, but what's your destination? Oh, you don't understand. As soon as the kickstand comes up and the motor rumbles to life, I'm already at my destination.
Very nice.
It's the journey that's the destination. It's the journey. That's why we're here. That's what we're doing. And once people wake up to that, they realize that whether they're suffering pain or disappointment or abundance or lack, it's all part of the adventure. Then the fear drops out of it. and the energy completely changes in their faces.
Well, how does karma play into all of this? I mean, I would imagine that a god of the universe and the universe wouldn't waste any energy, but there has to be some kind of karmic repercussions for negative energy in the universe. What are your thoughts on where the how the karmic energy gets dealt with afterwards?
Well, that's an amazingly good question. I think one of the main things that people get taught when they're young is that somehow along the way, maybe at birth, they got separated from God. They got separated from Source. And they spend their whole life trying to get back to where they're connected. They don't realize that they've been connected all along. And it was their own karma that seemed to make them feel separated. They were doing the exact thing they didn't want to do. Karma, for lack of a better word, it is the bounce back of energy from the universe. If you are constantly putting out the idea that you're afraid of doing anything or you're afraid of success, you're probably never going to succeed. One of my close friends is Michal Ledwith, and in his former life, he was a Catholic priest, and he was an instructor at the Catholic University. He had a woman come to him who had cancer, and she was middle-aged, I'd say maybe late 40s. And she came to him and said, "Father, I really do not understand why I got cancer. My mother got cancer when I was 9 years old, and I prayed every single day that I would not get cancer, and now I have it." And the priest said, "My God, woman, how could you not have it? You concentrated on it every day of your life, and you sent your fear energy out on top of it, and you manifested it yourself." The karma that we put out in the universe manifests our own life condition 100% without fail.
So in essence, these people running around doing bad things who go, "Well, I'm going to go to hell anyways," they're basically creating a negative afterlife for themselves, a negative karmic repercussion. It's all created by what you think.
Well, let's get something out of the way really quickly here. In the scriptures even, it says, "Judge not that ye be not judged." And if you want to continue that, it says, "Lest ye be judged with that judgment." There is no being anywhere in the universe that's sitting out there in a great throne saying, "You go to heaven, you go to hell. You go to heaven, you go to hell." Doesn't exist. We judge ourselves by our own state of energy, and the judgment is instantaneous. The instant we wish harm on another, the instant we give energy to jealousy or hatred, we have already lowered our energy state, and we have judged ourselves immediately.
Some people think judgment's coming in 2012. What are your thoughts on 2012?
I don't think it's judgment. I think it's a metamorphosis, and I think we're building toward it. It's like a crescendo. We already see the earth changes. We know that the earth is probably two different kinds of matter put together, a higher form of matter or a spirit matter and a lower form of matter or a temporal matter, not unlike the human body. And we know that they've been in resonance for several hundred thousand years. And we suspect, because of the great amount of gross national product that was invested in leaving us the signs, that we're going to be nearing this rift in the Milky Way, and the Earth is going to be going through some very unique changes, that maybe those two earths, those two halves, are going to separate. So this metamorphosis is going to count on the resonance of the beings on this planet. Those that resonate at a higher frequency will go with the higher frequency earth, and those that resonate at a lower frequency or a darker frequency are going to resonate with that temporal earth and stay with it. We will just become unaware of each other, and we will separate. So it is a time of metamorphosis. It is a time of awakening. It's a time of grand division. But I don't think it's a time of judgment.
So that could also be what the Christians refer to as the rapture event, a separation of people disappearing. In the arc of millions of years, you mentioned the Earth was actually made somewhere else and then brought here into this galaxy.
That's correct.
How did that happen, for the listeners?
This is a process we call the union of the polarity. That even when you read the book of Genesis, you will see that there are two creations. There's a temporal earth on which there's man created in God's image, and there's another earth that has Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and a much different progeny. You also see a great cataclysmic event called the Flood of Noah. Every single tradition on the earth has a flood story almost about the same time. We believe that this is about the time that the two Earths came together. If you go down and look in, for instance, the Museum of Anthropology in Mexico City, you will see depictions of an Earth coming through a wormhole and merging with this Earth in this orbit. And that depiction was made in 1200 BC, by the way. Now, the interesting thing is when we look at the composition of Earth and compared to our own moon, for instance, they're quite different. Earth is primarily iron and nickel. The moon is titanium and aluminum. They're not from the same neighborhood. The Earth is probably at least from the Sagittarius galaxy, at least the major portion that makes up the vibrant part of the Earth. So this is a process we call the union of the polarity, that the two Earths came together and occupy the same space around the sun at the same time.
Are these interdimensional? Is that basically what you're describing?
Yes, they are.
Okay.
What you have is a lower dimensional and a higher dimensional worlds existing in the same spot at the same time. It's not such a surprising idea. Just look in the mirror sometime. That thing that you see in the mirror is not you. That's just the flesh on the bones. The animated part that's on the inside is a completely different form of energy and very real.
I completely agree. That's what I try to convey to people over and over and over again, that this is just that it's flesh and it's not you. You are inside of it. And it's amazing when you go into a deep meditation, even astral projection, something like that. It feels kind of awkward, at least to me, when you come back from that, and the body feels so awkward, and it's like it's not you. That's what I try to get to people over and over and over again.
It's kind of like your car. You're not your car. Your body is just like your vehicle to get around in while you're experiencing this consciousness. So, you know, to make fun of somebody because of the way they look, that's just as stupid as making fun of somebody because of the way their car looks.
Well, that's true, although I think making some fun of someone's car is a lot more appropriate. you're talking to a person that's been in the automotive business his whole life and is now starting an electric car company, so cars are really important to me. The idea is that when you look in the mirror, you can almost see your own wings. You see that you're this leaping, flying, interdimensional being capable of contemplating the smallest quanta and the creation of planets all at the same time. You're not this person that hits his thumb with a hammer and realizes that he's, you know, 30 pounds overweight when he's 40 years old. The other thing to realize is that your consciousness is part of the environment in which your body is making the proteins that make up your physical shape. You shape yourself. You choose the way that you're going to look, the way that you walk, the way you cut your hair, the way you smile, the things that you eat. But your consciousness has a great effect on the health and vibrancy of your body.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking with Dr. Brooks Agnew discussing higher consciousness. We touched upon the Hollow Earth a little bit in the beginning. There are a couple of more questions I have about the Hollow Earth, though. One thing that you mentioned was global warming, and if the ice was to melt, then the sea levels would actually go down as it does in a cup of water. My theory is this, and tell me if I'm accurate. I mean, I'm not a scientist or anything like that. But if we did have some kind of melting event like that or a pole shift, we wouldn't see any difference because of the gravity being formed in the center of the crust rather than in the center of the Earth. Is that anywhere close to accurate? I mean, if we had a pole shift, would it cause total devastation?
Well, a pole shift would cause a rerouting of the jet stream, a rerouting of the Gulf Stream, migratory patterns and things like that, which would change the way seeds are dropped on the Earth, which would change the way fish move around the planet. So in that sense, it would be rather cataclysmic. Now, the process of the change is pretty quick. The sun does it about every 22 years. The Earth does it every now and then. I think we're overdue for it right now. This is where the North and South Poles actually flip. In physics, it's a process called the Coriolis effect, where you have a gyroscope that's reached a point of instability and it starts a wobble. And what happens is one day the undulation becomes too great and it just flips over. The crust flips over on the core. And this means that the sun would rise in the west instead of the east. So it would be it would definitely change everything. Would it be an extinction event? Possibly not. If all the ice melted, most of the ice is floating on water, so it wouldn't change the sea level at all. But it would change the salinity of the ocean, which would change the amount of heat that we retain from the sun. Now, that could really change the planet. Not so much in the temperature or how much shoreline we have, but underneath our ocean is another ocean made of methane, and we would like it to stay there. It's under a lot of pressure, and it's very cold. But if the sea gets too warm, then that methane begins to boil off and come through the sea and enter our atmosphere. And if that happens, we're at a point of no return, I'm afraid, for living on the surface of our planet without special breathing apparatus.
Well, that's
that'd be terrible.
Yeah, that's funny that you mentioned that, though, because I wanted to mention this earlier for the listeners. You know, if the Earth is actually hollow, when we found out that all these planets are actually hollow, there's a good possibility that there may be inhabitants right here in our very own solar system.
I would say so. You know, we are very lucky here in this world because we're in what's called the Goldilocks zone around the sun. Liquid water exists on the surface. That's pretty darn rare. We've got the Kepler mission out there looking for planets that have liquid water, and we haven't found one yet. Frozen water, yes. Steam, yes. But if you're going to live on another planet in our solar system or in the near visible areas, you're probably going to have to live on the inside of that planet.
Hmm. Have you noticed anything strange going on with the moon? We noticed it seems to be upside down. We thought we were crazy, so we Googled it to see if there's anybody else asking these questions. And surprisingly, there are other people asking these questions. What's going on with the moon?
Well, the way the shadow of the Earth moves across the moon is seasonal. We have had several very neat full moons this year. We had two in January. You know, the full moons are something to behold, but the one of the things people don't realize is we always are looking at the same side of the moon, which happens to be the dark side of the moon. The other side of the moon is six times brighter than the side of the moon that faces us. If that side of the moon faced us during a full moon, you'd probably have to wear sunglasses during a full moon. Why is that? Well, that's because as the Earth goes through this rift in the Milky Way, there's a layer of what's called dark matter or black matter, like an iron dust. And very slow rotating bodies get half coated with it. Fast rotating bodies like the Earth or several of the other planets in our solar system get evenly coated. If you look at the moon, it's half coated. If you look at some of the larger asteroids, they're half coated. Earth has a pretty uniform coating, although the Atlantic Ocean has between 36 and 72 inches of iron pellets on the bottom of it, more so than the Pacific Ocean. So it does look like one side of our planet got more of it than the other. But the moon, the crescent that you see, in the early spring is facing up, and that is normal.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking with Dr. Brooks Agnew. We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to be back to wrap it up. This is Truth Frequency on truthfrequencyradio.com. Join us every Thursdays at 7 p.m. Central Time on Polygraph Radio and every Saturdays on American Freedom Radio. We'll be right back.
Into the 1111 frequency, the energies shift and raise in light, quotient once more. The spiraling vortex of that which you know as time speeds up and intensifies the energies that create all that you resonate with and wish for and need. Your collective consciousness is at a level of alignment with cosmic frequencies as never before on your planet, as new understanding within so many reaches the point of clarity. Lightworkers and wayshowers are finally moving into places of unity with their soul families within the higher dimensions, and many are now reconnecting with their soul families on Earth. As brothers and sisters of light come together within a telepathic frequency of connectedness, they find that energy is shared and felt without words.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Truth Frequency with Chris Geo and Cherie. And we are speaking with Dr. Brooks Agnew. We're about to wrap up the broadcast. But Dr. Agnew, what do you think about 1111? That was an interesting clip. I didn't even mean to play that one. It just popped up. But what is your take on that?
Well, I wish I had a take on it. I'm not much for numerology. I really don't know what to make about 1111. I know that it shows up a lot of places. I know that people talk about it a lot, but and I'm a statistician, so I do look for patterns and numbers. But even though I haven't studied it much, I really don't see the significance of 1111. Maybe you can enlighten me.
I have no idea. All I can do is just speculate. I think 1111 is supposed to be when you're in touch with the universe. If you keep seeing it over and over and over again, it's kind of a message saying you're on the right path.
Well, I kind of like the Fibonacci sequence a little bit better. As you maintain that ratio of 1.618 to 1 and resonate with the universe, you make use of this natural energy that's bouncing back to you because of your karma. Now, I have to say, this works for good or for ill. So if you want to build great goodness in the world, you can certainly do it. If you want to build great evil in the world, it has a somewhat self-correcting function to it, but you can also use it to destroy.
Absolutely. And you host a radio show on X Squared Radio, isn't that correct?
Yes, X Squared Radio every Sunday night from 5 to 8 p.m. Pacific Time. We've been on now for 5 years and get ready to move into syndication finally.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Let's see, and what are your websites?
Well, the website is xsquaredradio.com, and then we also have phoenixsciencefoundation.org. This is where we examine cutting-edge scientific technology, mostly electric cars right now, but last year we built a state-of-the-art biodiesel plant in the Northwest. And there's still a frontier in electric cars. It's not in batteries. It's in charge as you drive technology.
Oh, that's cool.
There's still a great frontier in that.
Wow. Any new books in the works? Any follow-ups to Ark of Millions of Years?
Yes. The fourth book is coming out in about 1 week in ebook, and then in July it will be out in paperback and hardback at all the normal places. It's called Remembering the Future, The Physics of the Soul and Time Travel.
That sounds like a really good book. We're going to have to read that.
Absolutely. Anything you want to say before we wrap it up?
Well, I would like people to remember that that they are Source, that you're not separated from it at all, and there's lots of scientific evidence to back it up. Don't pay any attention to people who are saying that there's no link between science and spirituality, or that separation of church and state must be maintained at all costs. Without science, spirituality is pretty meaningless, and certainly spirituality without science is pretty empty. No tools to go with it. Remember that you are Source.
I always say that science is the way, not the why.
Ah, very good.
Yes, it's the method. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was Dr. Brooks Agnew. We really appreciate you joining us this evening and spending your time. And we'll definitely be tuning in every Sunday at 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, was it Eastern, Western? Eastern Pacific?
It's, 5 to 8 p.m. Pacific time.
5 to 8 p.m. Pacific time. All right. Very good. Well, we appreciate it, sir. You have a great evening.
All right. Thank you so much.
Well, that was absolutely amazing.
Fantastic.
I thought he was one of the greatest guests that we've had on so far. They could just keep getting better and better and better.
He's so knowledgeable.
I know. I don't even know where to go from here. I mean, how do you follow that up?
I don't think you can.
All right. So I guess on that note, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Truth Frequency with Chris Gio and Cherie. Join us every Thursday, 7 p.m. Central Time at truthfrequencyradio.com. The archives are available 24 hours a day for free download. And don't forget, we will be broadcasting on AmericanFreedomRadio.com every Saturdays at 7 p.m. So join us.
Caught on tape, the eyes were watching, they're looking for you. We walked under the radar, they took us to No, you won't. Hold it high, split down. I know you won't. It's freedom of speech, so I'm using it well.